The Church in the Last Judgment by B. Holwerda, translated by P. Y. de Jong and read by Rolof A. Jansen. The following is a translation of a speech delivered by Professor B. Holwerda at a youth meeting in 1949. It was translated by Dr. P. Y. de Jong, at that time professor at Calvin Seminary, Grand Rapids, Michigan. It has been published in several formats as a booklet and in installments in some magazines. The original Dutch is also included in the book Populaire Wetenschappelijke Bijdragen in 1962. B. Holwerda was professor at the Theological Seminary of the Reformed Churches in the Netherlands, Liberated, from 1946 until his death in 1952. In this speech, he refers to several political situations of his time. Please remember that the Second World War was history, with the bombing of the city of Rotterdam in May 1940, but that the Dutch soldiers were still fighting in the Dutch Indies. The Church in the Last Judgment. Since our subject concerns itself specifically with Revelation 17, we do well by way of introduction to provide a brief orientation into the composition and train of thought found in Revelation. It is my firm conviction that in Revelation we do not find different glimpses into history, so that time and again we arrive at the last day and thereafter again see history unfolding itself. Instead, the pattern of Revelation, more specifically its visionary section, contains but two distinct parts, namely chapters 4 through 11 and chapters 12 to the end. In chapters 4 through 11, God proclaims in visionary language the church as she performs her evangelistic task and perfects her preaching, while Christ reinforces this preaching and call to repentance by means of the judgment which he unleashes in the world. In this fashion, we should understand the entire vision of the seven seals, which are successively broken open. In this fashion, too, the vision of the seven trumpets, wherein the seventh seal is particularized and expanded, is illumined. All the judgments which Christ Jesus unleashes in the world, in the form of war and revolution, of famine and pestilence, of postponement of wrath aroused by the blood of the church, of world collapse, and especially of the seven final plagues, have but one aim. It is that of bringing the world to repentance and causing men to believe the word of Christ as proclaimed by the church. And only when all these attempts are stubbornly resisted, even in the last hour, will God put a stop to history and lead his church to victory. Those who hold this view will understand at once that at the beginning of Revelation, the center of the stage is occupied by the world, insofar as the church seeks to reach the world with the gospel of Christ Jesus. As soon as we come to Revelation 12, however, the scene shifts. There the church suddenly stands in the foreground, even though the world remains one of the chief actors in this drama. John tells us in Revelation 12 that he has seen a woman clothed with the glory of the sun and the moon and the stars. Thus, a woman adorned with heavenly glory, because she both brings forth the Christ in this world and is the mother of the rest of her seed, who keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. In this way, he introduces the church as Queen of the Light, who from the outset is contrasted with the dragon, the devil. He hates her not only because of her great son Jesus Christ, but also because of her other children, who keep his commandments. John, however, does not develop in detail the drama of the persecution of the church by the world, influenced by Satan. Actually, he finishes it in 1 second of chapter 12. He simply says, "And the earth helped the woman, for the earth opened her mouth, so that the river which the dragon spewed out after the woman was swallowed up by the cracks of the earth." Thus unto the woman could be shown a place for herself in the wilderness, where she could be safe at least from immediate annihilation. Thereafter, in chapter 13, John mentions the great monster who appears repeatedly in history, namely, the beast which ascends out of the abyss and receives all its authority from the dragon. In this way, the devil incorporates his dominion in a human power and allows that beast, which is the political world power, to be assisted by a second beast, which comes up out of the earth, the beast of false prophecy. But precisely how this develops, after what fashion false prophecy attacks the church and the world power opposes the church, John does not relate in detail. For again, although quite differently than in the first section of the book, he takes the leap to the last days. In chapter 14, the thought pattern of chapter 7 reappears. It is namely so that just before the last plagues of the seven trumpets break out, thus, after the opening of the sixth seal with its judgment and before the unleashing of the final judgment, the seventh seal, John announces that the church of God has been made secure. He has sealed the 144,000 upon their foreheads. Only then are the ultimate catastrophes set in motion. From this you realize that in chapter 14 we are at the end of history. Before describing the last drama from the church's viewpoint, he says again, "And I saw, and behold, the Lamb standing on Mount Zion, and with him 144,000, having his Father's name written on their foreheads. And they sang a song of praise before the throne, and before the four living creatures and the elders." When the great storm breaks, we find ourselves thus at the final moment of history. The sealing has been accomplished. Now appear the seven last plagues, which John first introduced as the seven trumpet plagues, but at this point announces as the seven phials, or seven bowls, filled with the last plagues. See the chapters 15 and 16. Thus the seven last plagues are poured out upon the earth by God. It is remarkable that, while John throughout this chapter has indicated only the outstanding events and leaves large gaps, he suddenly introduces in great detail, in connection with the revelation of the seven last plagues, the seven bowls, a unique figure, the great harlot, whose name is Babylon. In explaining this, I feel constrained to differ on some points with the exegesis of Professor Gridanus. As we begin to read this chapter, we discover that the details presented at the outset are somewhat difficult to reconstruct. For John tells us that he beheld a woman, decked out as a harlot, who sat upon seven heads and at the same time upon many waters. She sat upon the mountains, but also in the midst of waters. Likely, we should so combine these two pictures or representations that John, receiving the vision, beholds an island sea, wherein the beast is swimming. Thus, at this moment, only his heads are visible, and not his body. Since the author writes somewhat later, "The beast that you saw was and is not, and is about to come up out of the abyss." Another difficulty is presented by the seven heads. On the one hand, these are called the seven mountains, upon which the woman sat, and on the other hand, the seven kingdoms, seven kings, of which five have already fallen, and the sixth now is, and the seventh is yet to come. Perhaps we do best by beginning with the seven heads of the beast. This is the easier, since in chapter 13 the same description is found of a monster with seven heads and ten horns, and who has been endowed by the dragon with his power. Only in so far do the two descriptions differ, that in chapter 13 mention is made of the fact that one of the heads has been so severely smitten that the beast received a deadly wound, from which it could not be expected to recover. Yet contrary to all expectations, its death stroke was healed, with the result that when the beast recovered from this deadly blow, everyone on earth was ready to worship it. You will remember, of course, that when the writer of Revelation speaks about the beast, he is indicating the world power, the universal kingdom. This is the attempt to unite all peoples and nations and races into one great federation and under one powerful political structure. This he calls a beast, because this is the world power of a unified state which has scattered death and destruction since the beginning of the world. He could choose no other description, for too clearly has he seen in God's light that this world government is a monster which, like some wild beast, has seized everything within its reach and destroyed it. And in choosing this name, John is not alone, for he refers to Daniel. In the 7th chapter of his prophecies, Daniel actually says the same thing. When discussing the world monarchies, he mentions four, the four which existed in his day and in the time immediately thereafter. He informs us that the first was like a lion, the second like a bear, the third like a leopard, while the fourth was an altogether terrifying monster with iron teeth. It kept on devouring and stamped in pieces all the residue. All the characteristics of these different beasts are combined here. John describes but one beast, yet it displays all the features of the four beasts of Daniel. Actually, he says, it was like unto a leopard, and it had the feet of a bear and the mouth of a lion, and also the seven heads and ten horns. Thus Daniel beheld four distinct beasts. He saw that world power in its several manifestations, each with its own pattern and character. Therefore he could say that the first appeared in history, devouring as does a lion, the second brutish as a bear, the third cunning as a leopard, and the fourth as the most fearful of them all. But John says, if you discern well, you will discover in all these kingdoms one and the same satanic power which incorporates itself in a unified state, a world government, and as such always speaks blasphemy and brings death and destruction upon mankind. Because John sees the unity of all these diverse world powers, the single style which controls them all, therefore he speaks of only one beast and ascribes to it all the characteristics of Daniel's four beasts. Daniel wrote about the four of his own time. John says that actually there will be seven. He is farther along in history. But Daniel did not see as yet God revealed to John. Consequently, he says, we have already seen five heads of that beast. The one manifest now is the sixth. After a while, the seventh will appear. If you know your Bible, you will be able to glean from its pages what all this means. This totalitarian state and world power you will find for the first time shortly after the flood, in Genesis 11. It arose in Babel, where in opposition to the promise and mandate of God, mankind stayed together and built a city to house everybody. They reasoned, upon this accursed earth there is but one way to make life bearable. In unity lies our strength. For the first time, then, a world federation was organized there. And as you continue reading in the Old Testament, you will notice somewhat later the rise of the Assyrian power which shatters the people of Israel. Without interruption followed the Neo-Babylonian, the Medo-Persian, the Greco-Macedonian, and at last the Roman Empire, this last one known to John by personal experience. Thus the Roman Empire of that day was the sixth. Now I think you already understand one of the details of Revelation 13, the matter of the deadly wound which that beast received. For when the sixth head appeared on the scene, events took a new turn. The Roman world power was not succeeded by another, which took its place. Rather, that kingdom was repeatedly broken up into a large number of great and small nations. This paved the way for the modern period of time in history, in which every people proclaims its national independence and pursues a policy of neutrality, a period of countless clashes. Throughout this period, all attempts to resurrect the ancient world power of Babel are unsuccessful. This was tried by Louis XIV and Napoleon and Hitler, but to no avail. All of modern history is a concatenation of wars among the various nations of the world, all determined to defend their own independence. Consequently, throughout this period, between the 6th and the 7th world power, it appears as if the old monster had indeed suffered a deadly wound, one so decisive that it cannot rise again, with the result that history will follow the same course as today with its many peoples and nations and its innumerable national boundaries and barriers. The struggle for a worldwide empire, which has always inspired the devil and wherein he seeks his strength, seems to be frustrated for good. But John warns us, watch out, lest you be deceived. Look carefully and believe God's word. For indeed, at the time of the dissolution of the Roman Empire, the satanic organization of sin seems to have received its death blow without hope of recovery. But that which no one deems possible, in view of the perpetual clashes and conflicting interests, the permanent tensions among all peoples, will finally take place. The compelling urge for unity and federation will triumph over all particularism and national independence and national pride. At last, this spirit of unification will again embody itself in a world empire. Then, contrary to all expectations, that old monster, which throughout the ages has blasphemed God and wrought death and destruction, will miraculously arise. At that time, the spirit of lawlessness, which caused both Daniel and John to tremble, will begin anew. At that time, the church once again, even as Israel in the days of our Lord Jesus, will be confronted with the monster of sin, which terrorizes the church and tyrannizes over the world with a scepter of iron. At that time, everyone will worship that beast in the form of its seventh head. The world government, which has recovered itself from its deadly divisiveness through the ages, and now reveals its grand victory. To be sure, I need venture no prophecies concerning the future when I say in simple language, we are beginning to see that seventh head today. Isn't it true that preparations are being made even now for the seventh world empire? And would you know what is most surprising and also most dangerous? It is that all this takes place so quietly. During the war, there was the Atlantic Charter. Of course, we had to do something about the Germans, as did also the British and Americans. One simply had to join hands. Circumstances compelled it. What else could anyone do? And should one desire some future, one simply must not play the game of neutrality as in earlier days, or persist in swaggering about on one's own little legs. Everyone must conform to the demand of today's circumstances. And after the war, this tidal wave engulfed the whole world, with UNO, Security Council, United Nations, Atlantic Charter. Even the Netherlands is carried along. Of course, we all say, Benelux, that is Belgium, Netherlands and Luxembourg, appears on the scene, and the Netherlands enters into the alliance. Because if we do not join hands, then perhaps a more horrible war with atomic weapons will break out. Anyone who desires a future for the economy must learn to think and act and trade in terms of the family of nations. The United States of Europe is in the making. About this, the newspapers make mention of some initial discussions, a little item which is scarcely noticed. But this union is coming. And when the Security Council stirs in the troubled waters, as for example in the Dutch East Indies, then we all grumble. And when we take notice of all the fumbling of the past few years, we complain especially when our children are there. Some even wonder whether Benelux will be profitable for us. But a war wouldn't be so nice either. Thus, we are compelled to choose whether or not we will sacrifice our national aspirations. It is undeniable that not the Netherlands, but the UNO have their say in the Indies. And when all is said and done, Montgomery is also commander-in-chief of our soldiers. As soon as we realize this, further argumentation is fruitless. We can still wear the orange and display our Netherlands flag and honor the Dutch lion. But meanwhile, the Netherlands, together with all the other nations, will lose its identity in the world government. The newspapers will make much noise about changing a few boundaries for the sake of a few square miles of territory, and even challenge the party in power. But this noise will sound so foolish at a time when all national boundaries are being obliterated. But all this takes place so quietly.